Today is August 11th. It's the 224th day of the year, and this is the On This Day podcast. On this day in 1942, actress Hedy Lamarr and composer George Antheil receive a patent for the secret communication system, a frequency-hopping spread-spectrum communication system to be used as a radio guidance system for American torpedoes. Hedy Lamarr is not just an actress. She's a movie star. The most beautiful woman in films, as they call her. She's born Hedwig Kiesler in Vienna in 1914. And she begins her film career in the 1920s when she's discovered in Berlin. She marries Friedrich Mandl, an arms manufacturer, and accompanies him on a number of his business trips. She attends conferences and meetings with him, and while the men discuss a variety of military technologies, such as cutting-edge torpedo control systems, she takes it all in. The 4 years Hedy is married to Mandl make for a great education, but not a great marriage. In 1937, she flees to Paris, escaping her marriage and the growing influence of Nazi Germany. In Paris, Kiesler meets film impresario Louis B. Mayer, who brings her to Hollywood as Hedy Lamarr. In Hollywood, she makes a string of films, becomes that movie star, and also becomes bored with the whole thing. So to keep her brain stimulated, she begins inventing a better traffic light, a carbonated soda in tablet form, and a better missile guidance system. At the start of World War II, Hedy Lamarr focuses on national defense challenges. Thinking back to everything she learned in all of her ex-husband's meetings, she zeroes in on submarine warfare, and specifically the problem of shielding a torpedo guidance signal from enemy interference. She comes up with an idea for frequency hopping, randomly switching channels so the enemy won't know which frequency to jam. But she doesn't know exactly how to execute the idea until she meets composer George Antheil at a dinner party. Antheil is an avant-garde composer from New Jersey who thinks outside the box. One of his most famous works is the score to the film Ballet Mécanique, which includes, among other things, 16 synchronized player pianos. When the film premieres, it plays silent without Antheil's score. That's a whole other story. Bottom line, Cliff, he's got experience with syncing up player pianos. Antheil and Lamarr combine the concept of the player piano role with the idea of frequency hopping, coordinating the torpedo transmitter and receiver by controlling the switching of radio channels with two identical piano rolls, running at the same speed, changing radio frequencies simultaneously to prevent enemies from being able to detect the messages. Their patent that they receive on this day in 1942 includes a schematic showing a compact system of modulators, amplifiers, and the record strip, the piano roll concept. But when they try to sell it to the Navy passes on the invention. Afterwards, Antheil reflects on using the player piano analogy in their sales pitch and remarks, quote, "My God, I can see them saying, we can't put a player piano in a torpedo." After the Navy passes on Hedy Lamarr and George Antheil's frequency hopping system, it lies dormant for a few decades before it's resurrected in the 1960s and put to multiple uses. The frequency hopping spread spectrum system is the basis for pretty much all modern wireless telephone technology. Your mobile devices, your iPads, your flip phones, if you're still rocking that, your Wi-Fi, your Bluetooth, and even your drone warfare technology. If you want a deeper dive into Hedy's intriguing story, check out Karina Longworth's podcast, You Must Remember This. It's a fantastic show about Hollywood history And if you're into that, you'll love this podcast. And episode 29 is all about actress and inventor Hedy Lamarr. On this day in 1984, President Ronald Reagan is at his ranch near Santa Barbara, California, preparing to deliver his weekly Saturday address to the nation on National Public Radio. His topic on this day is the Equal Access legislation, which he just signed. His speech begins, quote, "My fellow Americans," and I won't do the impersonation, "my fellow Americans, I'm pleased to tell you that today I signed the legislation that will allow student religious groups to begin enjoying a right they've too long been denied, the freedom to meet in public high schools during non-school hours, just as other student groups are allowed to do." A little before the 9 a.m. live broadcast, however, the NPR audio technicians have him run through a few lines for a mic check, and he says this.
"My fellow Americans, I'm pleased to tell you today that I've signed legislation that will outlaw Russia forever. We begin bombing in 5 minutes."
The joke is not broadcast live. No one hears it outside Rancho del Cielo, the Reagan's ranch. But 1984 is an election year, and Reagan's up for a second term in just a couple months. So it's no surprise that the audio clip gets leaked and becomes a campaign issue when it's played a few days later on the CBS Evening News. But it also gets Russia's dander up, and the Soviets put their military on high alert. NBC's Tom Brokaw and Marvin Kalb at the State Department have more.
It was the joke heard around the world, the one by President Reagan about bombing the Soviet Union, and it resulted in a Soviet red alert, and it became a campaign issue in this country. Now, Marvin Kalb has learned that the Soviets responded in their own fashion.
The president was joking his way through an audio check on August 11th.
"That I've signed legislation that will outlaw Russia forever. We begin bombing in 5 minutes."
By August 14th, the story became world news, a major item on Moscow television where the joke was not treated as a laughing matter. August 15th, a coded message left Soviet military headquarters in Vladivostok. It said, in part, "We now embark on military action against the U.S. forces." The code was instantly broken by U.S. and Japanese intelligence. This is what then happened. A special command unit in Usurisk went on wartime alert. Key Japanese military units raised their readiness status. Soviet naval vessels in the North Pacific, baffled by the order, checked with Vladivostok. Confusion. U.S. intelligence urgently canvassed for signs of an imminent Soviet attack. Found none. Within 30 minutes, the mysterious Soviet alert was canceled. Was it unusual? Not according to U.S. officials.
Reagan wins the 1984 election, clobbering Walter Mondale in a landslide. So clearly the joke that so upset the Soviets was not a factor in the election, except maybe for Minnesotans. But were the Soviets really upset? For that, we go back to Marvin Kalb at the State Department.
"One senator said the alert must have been a joke. A congressman said it was Russia's way of answering the president. Most officials said no comment, though one did speculate that the Russian might have been drunk." Marvin Kalb, NBC News, the State Department.
There are 142 days left in the year. On This Day is produced by me, Dave Schultz. Thank you very much for listening. Born on this day in 1954, English singer, songwriter, performer, musical genius, the phenomenal Joe Jackson. This guy's worked across all genres of music. In the late 70s, he bursts on the British punk scene. He does ska, after that jazz, new wave, salsa, swing, cabaret, classical. You know his songs. Is She Really Going Out With Him? Stepping Out. I'm the Man. You Can't Get What You Want Till You Know What You Want. Be My Number Two. He's released 19 studio albums, a dozen live albums, and for me personally, they're some of the only albums I can listen to start to finish and not want to skip a single song. My favorite album is Live 1980-86. You're listening to it now. It's a tour de force. Joe Jackson, born on this day in 1954, is the man.
All right, thanks a lot.